Hello students, welcome back once again for a brief note on microbes in human welfare. So we are going to see a nutshell about the microbes in human welfare. In detail we have already studied in our regular classes, but now it is only just like a reminder or maybe just like a revision for the chapter microbes in human welfare. Microbes are diverse, means there are different types of microbes, which basically includes protozoans, fungi, bacteria, then viruses, viroids, prions. Okay, and we know that prions are proteinaceous infectious agents. Microbes like bacteria and fungi can be grown in nutrient media to form colonies and can be seen in the naked eyes. Okay, but individual microbacteria, which are microscopic in size, can be only observed under the microscope. But when they form a colony in a nutrient media as a colony, you can see them with your naked eyes. Many of the microbes cause diseases, and but along with that, we should know that microbes, some of the microbes are also known to be useful for human beings. Microbes are present everywhere. We know that in our first year chapter, we have studied that microorganisms that generally come under Kingdom Monera, they are said to be cosmopolitan in their habitat. That is, they are present everywhere. Okay, they are not only present in the favorable conditions, but you see that microbes can be present even in the unfavorable conditions also. So some of the unfavorable conditions that you see is the thermal vents of geysers where the temperature is above 1000 degrees. They can be found even in the deep soil, under the snow. Diverse bacteria like protozoa bacteria, fungi, virus, viroids, prions, they are present even in the soil. Okay, some of the bacteria, as we have already seen, right, they are known to be useful to us, and whereas some of them are known to cause diseases. Okay, so in this chapter, we are not studying about the harmful effects of these microbes, but we are studying about the usefulness of the microbes. Means, how are microbes useful for the human welfare? So first of all, in this synopsis, you have to know that microbes are being used in their household products. Okay, what are the household products that can be produced by using microbes? And one of the best example for this is the production of the curd from the milk. And the microorganism that is involved in the production of the curd is the lactobacillus and other bacteria, which all together are commonly called as the lactic acid bacteria, or you call them as the lab. They are grown in the milk and they convert the milk into curd. So during their growth, the lab produces acids that coagulate and partially digest the protein, that is the milk protein. Okay, what do these microbes do? They basically coagulate and then partially digest the milk protein, that is the casein. Okay, so as a result, you see that a curd is formed. Curd is known to improve the nutritional quality of by increasing the vitamin B12. That is, these microbes, they are known to increase or improve the nutritional quality of the milk by increasing the vitamin B12 content in the milk. In our stomach too, the lab plays a very beneficial role by inhibiting or by checking the other microbes or inhibiting the growth of the other microbes that are known to cause diseases. Then the second important product that has been formed by using a microbe, household product, that is the derp, which is used for making bread. Okay, so this derp is generally prepared by the fermenting action of the baker yeast called as the Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Okay, so derp, or the derp that is used for the preparation of the bread, is basically made by fermenting the bread by using the baker's yeast, which is called as the Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Third, a toddy, a traditional drink of some parts of the southern India, is also made by the fermenting sap from the palm. Okay, so you see that the toddy, which has been prepared, it is said to be the traditional drink, especially in the southern part of our India. It is basically made by fermenting the sap of the palms, that is the date palm or maybe some of the palm plants. Then microbes are also being used for the fermenting of a fish. Okay, right? You see that microbes are also used for fermenting of fish, soya bean, and as well as the bamboo shoots to make the food. Okay, right? You said to make the food. Cheese is one of the oldest item in which the microbes are being used. We know that cheese is one of the important dairy product which has been produced by the action of fermentation by using microbe. Okay, so there are different types of cheese depending upon which type of microbe that has been used for the preparation of the cheese. One of the most important cheese is the Swiss cheese, which is basically recognized by the presence of a large holes. So this Swiss cheese has been produced by the bacterial action of Propionibacterium sharmani. Propionibacterium sharmani is the microbe that has been used in the preparation of the Swiss cheese. And Swiss cheese is characterized by the presence of the large hole that are present in the cheese, which is basically produced by the how are these large holes that are produced? It is basically because of the production of large amount of carbon dioxide by this bacterium that is called as the Propionibacterium sharmani. Okay, apart from that, there is another important cheese called as the Roqueforti cheese. Okay, where the microbe called as the Penicillium Roqueforti is a microbe which has been generally used, or the bacteria which has been generally used for the preparation of this Roqueforti cheese. Okay, then these were some of the household products. Now let us move on to the microbes that are being used for the industrial products. So what are the industrial products that are being produced by the use of microbes? Okay, so microbes are being grown in a large scale in a very large vessel called as the fermenters, or they are also called as the bioreactors. So in a large scale, remember, the microbes are being produced and then they have been used for various purposes. The first purpose, industrial purpose use of the microbes is for producing fermented beverages. Fermented beverages, basically the microbe that has been used here is yeast, that is Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Okay, so this particular microbe is not only used for making the bread, but it is also been used for fermentation of malted cereals and as well as the fruit juices to produce ethanol or maybe to produce alcohol. For this reason, Saccharomyces cerevisiae is also called as the brewer's yeast, right? It is also called as the brewer's yeast, okay? Because it is used in brewing, or it is used in the fermentation of malted cereals and as well as the fruit juices. Wine and beer are produced without distillation, whereas whiskey, brandy and rum are produced by distillation of the fermented broth. These are some of the fermented drinks that are being produced by using microbes. Wine and beer are produced without distillation, whereas whiskey, brandy and rum are produced by distillation. They are some of the concentrated drinks that are being produced by using microbes. This is the first industrial use. Coming to the second industrial use is the production of antibiotics. What are antibiotics? Antibiotics are the chemical substances which are produced by some microbes and can kill or retard the growth of another disease-causing microbes. They are called as the antibiotics. And the first antibiotic that was been discovered was penicillin. Penicillin was been first discovered and it was been discovered as a chance by Alexander Fleming when he was working on a bacteria called as Staphylococcus. So what did he observe is, he observed that the mold growing in one of his unwashed culture plates around which Staphylococcus could not grow. Okay, so in some unwashed this petri plate or maybe in his petri dish, he observed that Staphylococcus was not able to grow. Then he found out that it was basically due to a chemical that was being produced by the mold, or it was basically produced by the fungus. and he named it as a penicillin because the later it was come to know that the mold that inhibited the growth of the Staphylococcus was a Penicillium notatum. Okay, so it was the Ernst Chain and Howard Florey who made a full potential effective antibiotics. So that is the effectiveness of the antibiotic was been first later discovered by Ernst Chain and as well as the Howard Florey. So this is the second important industrial product that has been obtained through microbes, right? We are only we come to know only about the penicillin, but apart from penicillin there are so many antibiotics like streptomycin, erythromycin, right, which are being used or maybe which have been produced by the microbes or like various different types of microbes, which are being used as an antibiotic. And these which are being used as an antibiotics are used in the treatment of various diseases. Okay, right, you see some of the diseases that are being cured by using antibiotics like leprosy or it may be the kalaza, that is the some of the bacterial diseases. Okay, so that is about the second industrial product. Then coming to the third industrial product is the production of chemicals, enzymes and other bioactive molecules. Okay, so some of the important chemicals that have been produced by using microbes are given as, okay, citric acid has been produced by Aspergillus niger. Then acetic acid has been produced by Acetobacter aceti. Butyric acid has been produced by Clostridium butyriculum. Okay, then lactic acid has been produced by Lactobacillus, whereas ethanol has been produced by Saccharomyces cerevisiae. These are some of the chemicals and the microbes that are been involved in the production of these chemicals. So remember students, this is one of another important topic which can be asked in your competitive exams. Then it is also used in the production of the enzymes. Okay, there are three important enzymes that are been mentioned in our NCERT textbook. One is the lipase. Lipase is generally used in the as a laundry detergent, especially to remove the stains. Okay, the stains from the cloth, right? Generally, lipase is being used. Then the pectinase and the protease is another enzymes that are being produced by using microbes. They are basically used for in the bottled juices for the clarification of the juices. Okay, right? You see that the juices are clarified using pectinase and as well as the protease enzymes that have been produced by the microbes. Whereas the third enzyme is the streptokinase. Streptokinase is an enzyme that has been produced by Streptococcus bacteria. It is basically used as a clot buster to remove the clots from the blood vessels. Right? You see that sometimes within the blood vessels also clots will be formed. Right? You call it as the thrombosis. In order to remove these blood clots, generally you see that streptokinase is used. And this particular streptokinase is obtained from a bacteria called as a Streptococcus bacterium. So hence they are called as the clot busters. Okay, then coming to a very important topic that is called as the bioactive molecules. Okay, there are bioactive molecules that have been obtained from the microbes which are being used in human welfare. One is the cyclosporin A. Cyclosporin A is a bioactive molecule which is generally obtained from a fungus called as Trichoderma polysporum. Okay, now this polysporum that is cyclosporin A generally is used as an immunosuppressant against the organ transplantation. That is, it will suppress the immune system, especially whenever there is an organ transplantation, maybe like a kidney transplantation or maybe cornea, eye cornea, when they have been transplanted, right? You see that they will suppress the immune system of the recipient. Okay, so that you see that the organs will match with the body of the recipient. So cyclosporin A is a bioactive molecule that is basically obtained from a fungus called as Trichoderma polysporum. Then statins. Statins are obtained from Monascus purpureus yeast, right? It is an yeast called as the Monascus purpureus. Now this particular statins are been used as blood cholesterol lowering agents. They are statins, or they are called as blood cholesterol lowering agents. That is, they lower the what you call it as the cholesterol in the body. Okay, so you can see here, this is the Trichoderma polysporum, whereas this one is the Monascus purpuree. Okay, these are the microbes that are generally are known to produce some of the important bioactive molecules that have been used in human welfare. Okay, so that was about the microbes in production, that is household production, industrial production. Now coming to the next is the microbes in the sewage treatment. We know that sewage disposal is one of the most important water pollutant, especially in the urban cities. Okay, so these sewage waste is being disposed by the residential areas, schools, then colleges, institutions. Okay, so now these sewage water that has been disposed by these residential areas have to be treated before they are been disposed or they have been discharged into the water bodies. So in order to treat this sewage water, microbes are being used. Okay, so treatment of the waste water is being done by a heterotrophic microbes naturally present in the sewage. Okay, by making use of the heterotrophic microbes, especially the saprophytic microbes, you see that the sewage water has been treated. Sewage treatment has been carried out in two stages. One you call it as the primary treatment, whereas another one is the secondary treatment. Primary treatment is also called as the physical treatment. It basically involves the removal of the particles from the sewage by filtration, that is sequential filtration, and as well as sedimentation. Now, by physical method, you are physically removing some of the impurities, that is solid impurities that are present in the sewage water. And these solid impurities may be in the form of paper or cloth or plastic or maybe gravels or maybe soil or sand. So they are basically removed with the help of this physical treatment by subjecting the sewage water through filtration, that is sequential filtration and sedimentation. Okay, so by carrying out this method, please remember, you get what called as after sedimentation, all the impurities, they will get settled at the bottom of the tank, that is the primary treatment tank. So this particular sediment that gets settled at the bottom of the tank, you call it as the primary sludge, which is generally taken and it has been used for land filling. Okay, whereas the supernant, remember, there will be two parts. Supernant is the water that is seen, which is clear, and all the what you call it as the soil particles and all, they get settled. The supernatant that has been used will be subjected now for the secondary treatment, and secondary treatment is called as the biological treatment. Now you may be thinking that supernatant is very clear. Why? Because all the impurities that are present, already they have settled. No, students, you see that this particular supernatant also has got some unseen impurities, and these unseen impurities are nothing but they are the microbes. This is causing microbes, so hence they have to be treated. So so for that reason, secondary treatment or biological treatment is being carried out. So biological treatment basically involves, or the secondary treatment involves, aeration, production of the activated sludge, and then anaerobic sludge treatment called as the anaerobic sludge digestion. Okay, so let us first see about the, as I have already told you, the primary treatment. It involves the physical removal of the particles from the sewage through filtration and sedimentation. Sequential filtration to remove floating debris, whereas sedimentation to remove grit, that is soil and small pebbles. All solid that settles form the primary sludge, and the supernatant form the effluent. So now this is the supernatant which will be subjected for the secondary treatment. Okay, so now let us see about the secondary treatment. Can you see here? This is a The secondary treatment tank, okay, it is the aeration tank. So the primary effluent will be passed into a large aeration tank. Now these are the aeration tank, and this allows, so, and the water has been agitated. Due to the agitation of the water, remember, there will be a vigorous growth of the aerobic microbes, okay, remember, aerobic microbes, they grow. And these aerobic microbes, they form what called as the floss. What does the floss here refers to? Floss here refers to the microbes and as I mean bacteria, filamentous bacteria, and as well as fungi, which generally form a mesh like structure. This you call it as the floss, or you call it as the flocks. While growing, these microbes consume the major part of the organic matter in the effluent. So when these flocks, they grow in the water, they start consuming all the organic matter that is present in the water, right? Please remember, the water also is known to contain organic matter. Organic matter, which basically includes the urine, the excreta, human excreta, and excreta of the animals. So you see that they start decomposing the organic matter that is present in the effluent. This significantly will reduce the BOD. What is BOD? It is the biochemical oxygen demand of the effluent. So you see that as a result of the growth of the microbes, the BOD of the water will be reduced. So BOD, what does BOD refers to? BOD is the measure of the organic matter that is present in the water. Greater is the BOD, you have to remember, more is the water that is polluted. Okay, so it is an index to show that how much the water is polluted. If the BOD is more, remember, the water is more polluted. But if the BOD is less, then the water is less polluted. Okay, now once the BOD of the sewage water reduces significantly, the effluent is then passed into a settling tank. Okay, right, you see here, this is the settling, the other settling tank. So now in this settling tank, what happens is all the floss are allowed to sediment. The floss that has been grown, now they are made to settle down. This sediment that gets settled at the bottom of the settling tank, please remember, you call it as the activated sludge. Okay, this activated sludge is very important, because this activated sludge, a small portion of the activated sludge is being pumped back into the aeration tank. Okay, it is being pumped back into the aeration tank. Why? Because it will serve as the inoculum, right? It will serve as the inoculum. So, because it serves as an inoculum, remember, this activated sludge is very, very important. Now, what about the water? Now, the water is clear. Why it is clear? There are no more pollutants present. So now this water that has been clarified can be subjected either to tertiary treatment, which mainly involves treating the water with some of the disinfectants like chlorine. And then once it has been treated, remember, the water will be now discharged into the water bodies. But what about the activated sludge? The activated sludge is now pumped into anaerobic sludge digester. Now this is the anaerobic sludge digester. So now this in this you see that the completely the sludge is being digested, or it is subjected for digestion by using certain anaerobic bacteria. So when the anaerobic bacteria will start growing on this activated sludge, please remember, it is known to produce a mixture of gases such as methane, hydrogen sulfide, and carbon dioxide, which together forms what called as the biogas. Okay, so now this biogas can be used for domestic purposes, maybe for lighting the lamp, or maybe it can be used for the cooking purpose also. So the effluent, as I have already told you, the effluent from the secondary treatment plant is generally released into the natural water bodies like the river and the streams. Okay, sometimes they are also being given tertiary treatment where a disinfectant like chlorine is being added. Okay, so that was about the how the sewage water is being treated. Now, microbes play a very major role in treating millions of gallons of wastewater every day across the globe. Okay, this is how you see that globally the sewage water are being treated. Now, till date, no man-made technology has been able to reveal the microbial treatment of a sewage. Means we don't have any man-made technology for treating the sewage. Okay, no, it is only the microbes which can treat the sewage waste. The Ministry of Environment and Forests have initiated the Ganga Action Plan and Yamuna Action Plan to save these two major rivers in our country from pollution. So you see that there is a plan for cleaning the Ganga River and as well as the Yamuna River under this plan called as the Ganga Action Plan as well as the Yamuna Action Plan. Now, under these plan, what is the main purpose of this plan? The main purpose of this plan is to produce or maybe build large number of sewage treatment plant. Large number of sewage plant has to be planted in across the different important cities so that not only the sewage water is treated, but it can be after treating, it can be discharged into the rivers. Okay, right. So thus the two purpose of the Ministry of Environment and Forest is to establish or maybe to plant many sewage treatment plants in many of the cities, big cities. And secondly, right, the sewage water that has been treated, it has to be treated properly and then that has to be discharged into the rivers. Okay, so that was about the microbes in sewage treatment. Now let us move on to the next, that is microbes in the production of a biogas. Okay, so first let us understand what is biogas. Biogas is a mixture of gases that have been produced, that is being produced by the microbial activity and which may be used as a fuel. Okay, it is a mixture of gases and it is being produced by microbial activity and can be used as a fuel. So these bacteria which have been used for the production of the biogas basically are anaerobic. Okay, so these bacteria they are grown anaerobically on the cellulosic material produced on a large amount of methane along with carbon dioxide and hydrogen. Okay, so now when these anaerobic bacteria, they start decomposing the cellulosic material like the cow dung, they produce large number or the large amount of gas like methane, carbon dioxide and as well as hydrogen. And the bacteria which have been generally used for the production of the biogas, they are collectively called as the methanogens, and one of the bacteria called as methanobacterium. Okay, methanogens they are called as. Now these methanogen bacteria, naturally if you see, they are generally seen present growing in the rumen of the cattle. So ruminant animals like the cattle. So a lot of cellulosic material present in the food of the cattle is also present in the rumen. And with the help of these bacteria, please remember the cellulose that has been present in the rumen of the cattle is being broken down. Okay, and plays a very important role in the nutrition of the cattle. Remember, cellulose can be digested only with the help of cellulase enzyme. And this cellulase enzyme is being produced by the methanogens, which basically helps in breakdown of cellulose, which is present in the cellulosic plant material. So thus, you see that it not only helps in breakdown of the cellulose, but it also helps in providing nutrition to the cattle. Thus, the excreta or the dung of the cattle, which is commonly called as the gober, is rich in this bacteria. Okay, so gober serves as a rich source of this methanogen bacteria. So the dung can be used, so the cow dung can be used for generating biogas, which is commonly called as the gober gas, or you call it as the biogas. Okay, so now let us try to understand the biogas plant. The technology of biogas production was being developed in India mainly due to the efforts of Indian Agriculture Research Institute, that is IARI, and Khadi and Village Industries Commission. Okay, these were the two important organization which were generally used. Generally, they were the one who took the step for the production of the biogas. So now, what is a biogas plant? Biogas is a concrete tank, right? It is a concrete tank. in which bio waste is being collected. Okay, so you can see here, this is the collecting tank where a slurry of the dung is being fed. Okay, right, you see that the dung is being fed into the concrete tank. The concrete tank is generally present within the soil, that is inside the soil surface. It is a concrete tank. Okay, then the entire biogas, I mean the biogas plant or maybe the concrete tank is being covered by a floating tank. I mean the floating cover. This is called as the gas holder. Okay, right, now as the gas is produced in the tank, please remember the gas will rise. And as a result, so this gas will be produced due to the microbial activity. So as the gas is produced, please remember the gas holder keeps on rising. Okay, right, it keeps on rising. Then the biogas plant has an outlet, right? There is an outlet present. So this outlet will be connected to the pipe for the supply of the biogas to the nearby houses. Okay, whereas the left out slurry, right, is been collected in another tank. Right, this is the outlet of the tank, so this is called as a sludge. Okay, so this sludge is been used as a fertilizer. So the biogas thus produced is used for cooking and as well as for the lighting purpose. Okay, now coming to the next is about the use of microbes as a biocontrol agent. Biological control of pests and diseases. Students, you have to remember that many of the plants have been attacked by the pest. Okay, right. So these are the nothing but they are the predators. Okay, since from time immemorable, when agriculture started, man has been trying to fight against these pests which are destroying the crops. So pesticides cannot be insecticides and pesticides. Of course, they serve the purpose and control the growth of these pests on the crop plants. But they have got many other side effects also, right? You see that they are known to cause they are known to cause soil pollution. Then they are known to kill many of the fauna, that is other insects that are present in that particular area. So they have their own drawback. So hence we are going for an alternate method of controlling these pests. And this alternate method for controlling the pest is the biological control. Okay. So now in biological control, we are using some of the microorganisms for controlling these pests. Okay. Ladybird is being used for controlling the aphids. You can see here, this is the ladybird and it has been effectively used for controlling the aphids, which are one of the pests for the crop plants. Dragonfly is used for controlling the mosquito larvae. Okay, dragonfly is known to feed on the larva of the mosquitoes. Okay, now microbes that have been used as biocontrol agents are Trichoderma, right? So this is the Trichoderma. Trichoderma fungi, which is known to protect the root system, and along with that, it is known to control the plant pathogens. Okay, they control the plant pathogens. Then the second group of microbes are the baculoviruses. Baculoviruses are a group of nucleopolyhedroviruses, which generally attack the insects and the other arthropods. So they are what? They are like hyperparasites. Already there are parasites on plants, and upon that they grow as parasites. So they are hyperparasites. Now baculoviruses are a group of viruses that belong to nucleopolyhedroviruses, which are known to attack the insects and other arthropods. Whereas the third group of microbes that have been used as biocontrol agents are the Bacillus thuringiensis, which is called as the biocontrol agent, especially against the cotton. Okay, BT cotton, right? It is known to control wide range of insects. And let me tell you one point here, students. Baculoviruses are said to be very species specific. Okay, right, you see that. Okay, so that is about broad spectrum. I mean, they are said to be an as narrow spectrum. Okay, so that is about the microbes as a biocontrol agents. Coming to the last is the microbes as biofertilizers. Okay, biofertilizers are organisms that enrich the nutrient quality of the soil. So generally, to enrich our soil, we make use of chemical fertilizers like urea and all. Okay, and these chemical fertilizers, once again, they have a bad effect on the environment and as well as it has got a bad effects on human beings also when we consume the plants that have been sprayed or that have been used the chemical fertilizers. Hence, we have to go for a alternate method, that is the use of biofertilizers. Okay, so what are the main sources of these biofertilizers? The main source for the biofertilizers are bacteria, fungi, and cyanobacteria. First, let us see about the bacteria. One of the best bacteria, or maybe which has been used as a biofertilizer, is rhizobium. Rhizobium is a bacteria which is generally grows as a root nodules of leguminous plants and is able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen. You can see the root nodules here. Okay, it is able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen. There are other free living bacteria also like Azobacter and Azospirulum, which are also known to fix the atmospheric nitrogen. Hence, now these bacteria are being used as biofertilizers. Okay. Now, you can see some of the other microorganisms that have been used as biofertilizers. Rhizobium. This is Azotobacter. Now, blue-green algae, right? Then you see Azospirulum, then mycorrhiza. These are some of the microorganisms that have been used as biofertilizers. Fungi. One of the most important fungi that has been used as biofertilizer is mycorrhiza. Myco means fungus, rhiza means roots. So what are mycorrhiza? Mycorrhiza are the fungi, they are the soil-borne fungi which generally get associated with some of the roots of some of the higher plants. And they help the plant in various ways. That is, they help in absorption of phosphorus from the soil. They help in the overall growth and development. They help in protecting the plants against salinity, right? They also help in protecting the plants against soil-borne microbes. So these are the uses of mycorrhiza. So hence now mycorrhiza have been used as biofertilizers. And one of the most important genus of mycorrhiza that has been used as biofertilizer is the glomus. Then, coming to the third group of bacteria or the microbes that have been used as biofertilizers are the cyanobacteria. Okay, the cyanobacteria like Nostoc, Oscillatoria, Anabina are being used as biofertilizers. Why? Because like rhizobium, even these Nostoc, Anabina and Oscillatoria are able to fix the atmospheric nitrogen, and as a result, they are known to enrich the soil. So, you should know that Anabina grows as a symbiosis in the leaves of a fern called as the Azolla. So, now hence Azolla now is grown on a large scale and has been used as biofertilizer, especially for the paddy fields. Okay, right, you can see here, this is the Azolla. So, the leaves of the Azolla has got the colonies of Anabina. Now, Azolla has grown on a large scale and has been used as biofertilizers. So, this is how you see microbes are also being used as biofertilizers, and they are known to enrich the soil nutrition or maybe the soil content. So, this was a brief note about microbes in human welfare. So, it was like a quick glance. It was like a quick glance of the chapter microbes in human welfare. It may help, will help you for preparing for your competitive exam. Thank you, students.